Simulation race. The 50-year-old racing buddy of Supertex, A.J. Foyt, just trying to get into the main event. Meanwhile, Eric Gordon was flat running away up front. But look here. In black, George sneaking down to the inside of Brent Keating and taking over third spot. And his next victim, the red 29 of Kenny Schrader. Suddenly, George is second. And when Eric Gordon burned the tires off his car, there was George to steal the moment and take the checkered flag. And so tonight, the old guard, George Snyder and Johnny Parsons and the resurgent Larry Dixon take on the young Lions. Eric Gordon, former Silver Crown Rookie of the Year, hoping he learned a winning lesson here a year ago. Robbie Stanley, twice a winner this year in sprints, series leader in that division. A dirt track charger who will smoke the tires and split the leaders on pavement as well. And this guy, Jeff Gordon. Last year's hero in the open wheelers, now chasing stock car glory, but finding time along the way to win the Holman 100, the last outing for these spectacular cars. Jeff's still something when he gets in an open wheeler. Let the veterans think about that. With two Silver Crown wins, Gordon may have a wheel up on the competition. One of the biggest crowds we've seen this year at Indianapolis Raceway Park have gathered for the USAC Silver Crown cars, the Pepsi 100. They've filled the grandstands and lined the banking in a perfect evening for racing. We've had 92 hundredths of an inch of rain in the month of June here in Indianapolis. That's 3 inches below normal. Every drop of it that's fallen fell on Saturday Night Thunder. But tonight, not a chance of a shower. Hello, everyone. I'm Dave Despain, and tonight we have living history here at Indianapolis Raceway Park. I give you the Silver Crown cars. These are the cars that raced at the Indianapolis 500 40 years ago before they were displaced by the Roadsters. But these cars lived and raced on. In the 70s, they got their own championship division, and tonight they're going to go 100 laps here for the gold and the glory. Yeah, they look a lot like sprint cars. They're about 10 inches longer, and they have a little less engine. 355 cubic inches the limit. This one is a V6, the only one in the field, and it's going to start from the pole tonight. One of the key stories is back here at the back of the car. The V8s are going to start tonight with 35 gallons of fuel, about 350 pounds of fuel, right back here over the rear wheels. As that fuel is burned off, the car is going to shed all of that weight, and that means chassis setup has got to be one of the critical factors. Now, we talked at the top of the show about the veterans versus the kids. Well, the veterans won qualifying, I'll tell you that. Johnny Parsons Jr. will start from the pole, and alongside the series champion Jimmy Sills. Tell me what it's going to take to win this thing tonight, Johnny.
Well, Dave, it'll take a lot of consistency, and a driver in the course of the 100 laps may have to adapt and change his driving styles to the track conditions, and they will change.
Is this a rabbit or a tortoise kind of a race?
Somewhere in between. You're going to have to concentrate on saving your equipment and being there at the end, mainly the right rear tire. Keep it cool as you can.
So that's the most important thing you got to save.
I would say so, yes.
You going to finally finish one of these things?
Well, I sure hope so.
Well, it's a jam-packed front row with this guy starting from the pole. We said it's going to be the veterans versus the kids. Let's get the rest of the rundown here as we go up topside and hear from the guys that will call the action tonight, Gary Lee and Larry Rice. Guys?
Thanks to Dave Same. Hi, everybody. And talk about young and old, Larry Rice. And I can't even get it out tonight. Larry is a two-time champion of the Silver Crown Division who would love to be down there driving with you. We're going to hang on to him up here. We have been accused of being Jeff Gordon's PR agents on ESPN. The 19-year-old's had a phenomenal career, and just today he finishes sixth in a Busch Grand National race at Watkins Glen. Has to change clothes on the airplane. Not a bad hurdler. Runs across the track. His car is waiting. He qualifies third quick.
Yes. I have a favorite quote about him. Dizzy Dean once said, it's not bragging if you've done it, and I've done it. Well, everything we've said about Jeff Gordon is true. He's done it. He has one other important factor this year. He's run a lot of long races in NASCAR. That's helped him a lot. Outside of him is another guy, a veteran who's run a lot of long races. The Indianapolis 500 included Stan Fox. The next row is old versus the new with Wally Pankratz, a veteran, and Eric Gordon, who I'm sure learned a lot from George Snyder last year.
It was touched on earlier by Johnny Parsons. Strategy, conserve the car, maybe go slow to go fast.
Well, this is a very fast sprint race for 100 laps that you have to be conservative in, and that's very hard to do. You have to save the right rear tire, as he said. And you also have to set the race car up so it's as fast at the end as it is in the beginning. And with 350 pounds of fuel over the back, that's very hard to do.
We talk about racing 100 laps, but first we have a 25-lap qualifier coming up next. Dave?
That's how we're going to kick things off. The fastest 14 qualifiers have transferred directly into the championship feature here today, the 100 lapper, and they will start straight up. All the rest of the non-qualifiers are going to run this 25 lapper to try to earn the 10 transfer positions that will get them into the feature. We're going to show you every lap of it, of course, here, and here's how the qualifying race will line up. Bob Ciccone, an old friend on Saturday Night Thunder, alongside Warren Mockler up there in row one for this 25 lapper. With the top 10 to move up. Jim Keeker, former winner here on Thunder, along with Steve Butler, who won a sprint car feature right here at IRP earlier this year. Greg Staub and Danny Smith will share row three, positions five and six, and they'll be followed by Tony Elliott and another of our Thunder winners in a midget car. Mike Fedorchik lines up outside row four. In row five, we'll have Gary Heber and a former winner of this race, Jeff Bloom, in car 95 on the outside. In row six, it's going to be Chip Thomas squaring off against Trey House as they try to get to the front. They've got to pass people to qualify. Jerry Niemeyer and Joey Allen comprise row seven as we work our way to the back of the field of non-qualifiers here. Gary Irvin and Brad Marble. Marble's been a winner in the sprint car division this year. They'll be in row eight. Row nine has Matt Berryhill Jr. and Brent Whitehead side by side. And as we go back to round out the starting lineup, all alone back there will be Randy Bateman, alone in row 10 for this 25-lap qualifying event, the top 10 of which will occupy starting spots in tonight's 100-lap feature. They're just about ready to go green. Let's go topside for the Gary and Larry Show.
Well, once again, the fastest 14 will be starting straight up in our 100-lap feature. These are the guys that qualified 15th through the balance of the field. Surprising, Larry, to see Bob Ciccone back there in the 15th position. He won a 75-lapper Silver Crown race here 2 years ago.
Yes, he did. Steve Butler's in this race. He's also won a lot of these races. You know, there's a lot of guys that just weren't quite quick enough. Warren Mockler had fast time here last year. He's starting outside the hooligan or the semi this year that he didn't expect to do.
It has been very hot, very humid. The track was very, very slick in practice and qualifying earlier.
Yes, it was slick, but these guys are going to have a little bit of an advantage. We saw George Snyder win the race after running in this semi last year. These guys have the advantage to know what happens after the sun goes down, and the sun is going down now.
A pair of veterans in the front row as Bob Ciccone picks up the throttle, brings them off the corner. There is the green flag, the 25-lap qualifying race. The first 10 finishers will transfer to the 100-lap main event.
Oh, look at that. Jim Keeker clear down on the bottom, smoking the tire way up there in front. He's down under Bob Ciccone, but he got way sideways down there and almost lost the whole race car.
Well, Warren Mockler in the blue and white number 75 out in front. There is Ciccone looking to the inside, coming off the fourth corner.
It looks like he's got it. No, not quite. It's very, very difficult. 10 cars make this race, but the farther up you finish in this race, the farther you start in the main event. So they're all going to try to pass as many guys as they can. You don't have to conserve the tires in this race. They all should last 30 laps very easily.
Good look there at the white number 44 of Greg Staub. We go back to the front of the pack, and Bob Ciccone made that pass very easy on the inside without smoking the right rear tire.
Well, these cars are going to run a 25-lap semi. They usually run a 30-lap main in the sprint cars here. So with a 25-lap main here, they have the tires on there that are hard enough to last 100. So it should not be a problem. So these guys are going to go for it. They're going to press. They're going to slide sideways if they have to. They're going to do whatever it takes to get up front, as Keeker's doing right there.
First four cars right there in your frame. Ciccone leads it. And then it's Warren Mockler, Jim Keeker in the black number three, and then Greg Staub in the white 44 as Keeker looks to the inside coming off the second corner.
Yes, he does. He's doing a real good job. He's trying to figure out. He thinks he's got it figured out to where he can pass him coming off, but he loses the momentum when he turns down underneath him. He just doesn't quite get going fast enough.
Longer wheelbase. They have to drive out in front of the race car, perhaps anticipate. They can't just dart down to the inside like they would the midget here.
Well, there's not as much horsepower in these cars as there would be in a sprint car, so it's more important to keep your momentum up in these cars than it would be in a sprint car. You don't have the instant 1,000 horsepower. So you've got to find a nice, smooth line that you're very, very quick and the momentum keeps up in.
Keep in mind, the first 10 finishers will go on to the main event. The winner will start no better than 15th as we look back in the pack. There was a look at car number 92 going into the first corner. That is Mike Fedorchuk, the pavement veteran out of Fort Wayne, Indiana, in his first ever ride in a big silver crown car. And he chases Gary Heber down the backstretch. Gary Heber, the winner of last year's Hoosier 100, the richest of the dirt car races on the tour.
Yes, and it looks like Fedorchuk is getting that race car figured out a little bit. He went in high. He was much faster than Heber. Heber entered real low. And I think if you watch, Fedorchuk got close to the end of the fence. He got a little wiggly getting in there and almost caught the fence. But I think you're going to see him come up behind Heber down here and try to maybe diamond down under him. Heber will go in low and then slide up high. No, he didn't do it that time. He entered a lot higher that time.
You can see a bigger lead now being pulled away by Bob Ciccone. A good battle still for second position as that black number three of Jim Kieger looks again to the inside of Warren Mockler. May have the pass made coming off the second corner down the backstretch.
Yeah, it looks like he's got a good shot. No, he just doesn't have the speed off the corner. I would guess that he does not have a low enough gear. I think he's just geared a little bit too high.
Jeff Bloom there makes a move to the inside. That's Jeff Bloom in that dark number 95. We have seen him here on ESPN with his number 67 sprint car. And he makes a move to the inside of car number 50.
Boy, that's Danny Smith that he's trying to get around. That's a wobbly wheel car. That's an independent suspension front car. Jimmy Smith. The 95 car is independent front suspension. It does not have a solid front axle. That car is very experimental. There are not very many of them. I think that's the only one here. And it makes them a little bit more difficult to work with.
Well, also, Danny is what I would consider a dirt car specialist. To put him on a pavement in an experimental car, well, that's hands full.
Danny Smith is not in the experimental car. That's Jeff Bloom. I may have misled you there. The one throwing the sparks, the orange one, that's Danny Smith. He's lived in Indianapolis his whole life and never driven a lap around this racetrack until today. I find that hard to believe. But look at Chick Thomas.
Chip Thomas almost in trouble there. He pulled alongside of Bloom.
Oh, he's spilling something out of there. He's losing oil.
There's a wall coming up here. Yeah. That will bring out the yellow, and that will revert back to probably 8 laps complete.
He was going real quick. He got inside those guys going down the backstretch. Looked like he had a good shot, but he got down there and the oil started coming out of him. I'm sure that's oil coming out all over the place, and he just couldn't hang on with all that oil under his wheels.
I wanted to go back, Larry, to the shot we had earlier of Mike Fedorchuk up close to the fence. How forgiving are these race cars compared to the sprints of the midgets that we've seen here?
Let's see this replay first, Gary. Look, he got sideways there. He saved it. You can see all the oil coming out the back. He tries to say he saves it again, but he keeps trying to stay on the gas. He doesn't realize what's going on. The third time's a charm. He just couldn't hold it the third time. You know, 1, 2, 3 strikes, you're out, and you're around and out of the ball game.
Well, he locked it up and kept it off that concrete wall, and that wall can be very unforgiving. But once again, how forgiving are these cars?
Well, they're pretty forgiving. These race cars are long enough that you can be forgive. You know, they'll forgive you a lot of mistakes. But, you know, you've still got to be on top of things.
Well, 10 laps are now complete. Clerk Greg Staub and Steve Butler, the first 10 finishers, will transfer to the main event. Riding in the second 5, Gary Heber, Mike Fedorchuk, Danny Smith, Jeff Bloom, and Trey House. 10 of 25 laps now complete.
Yes, I think that was water that was coming out. See, they didn't put any oil dry on it, so that leads me to believe that it was water coming out of the car, but still very, very slick at 100 miles an hour, and it will turn you around real quick.
Well, keep in mind, George Snyder, who won this thing last year, started 16th. He had to go through the hooligan to make the main event. They pick up the throttle. Bob Ciccone will lead them off the fourth corner, but look at Kieger. He looks to the inside. He wants to take a shot at Ciccone.
Yeah, Jim Kieger got a real good shot on him, tried real hard to get underneath him, but couldn't quite make it stick. Ciccone had this trouble at Winchester a couple weeks ago in the midgets. He didn't get very good starts on the restarts, and the guys behind him got a little jump on him. It didn't look like he got as good a restart that time as Kieger did in that black car, but Kieger just couldn't quite sneak around him going into one.
We've talked a lot this season about racing terminology. Kieger is carrying the wheel. He is carrying that left front down the backstretch.
Well, that just means that the right rear bar is not quite stiff enough. Really, ideally, the wheel on that left front should stay on the ground to help hold the race car, help stabilize the race car. When that left front starts flopping around up in the air, it makes the race car wiggle. It's not nearly as stable when that wheel's off the ground. So ideally, they should do something to that race car before the main to get that left front back on the ground.
When you say a bar, you're referring to the torsion bar. Almost all these cars are torsion bar cars, except for, Jimmy Sills has that coil car.
There are some coil spring cars. There are some torsion bar cars. But however the suspension is, they have to get it set up so that all four wheels stay on the ground, because that left front waving up and down like it's doing right there. See it jumping up and down. Every time it jumps up and down, it tries to make that right rear tire break loose, and that's not good.
13 laps now complete, 12 laps to go, and So Warren Lochler will be a spectator for our 100 lap feature. He was the quick timer last year.
That's a tough break for him. He doesn't run a lot. Uh-oh, we got trouble.
That is Danny Smith. Danny Smith, and he's dragging something up the sparks fly coming down the backstretch.
That's very tough luck. He was causing sparks a while ago. It looked like they had the car a little bit low. He might have stripped a bar off on that car, a torsion bar, and that's what's dragging down there, the whole car. Look at this. Jim Kinker, though, he's trying to get it. Oh, boy. Close right there. He almost had Ciccone, but Ciccone's pushed the front end a little bit there, but he still couldn't quite get around.
Kinker starting to smoke that right rear, though, as he tried to maintain that line down low.
Yes, he can do that in this race without any problem. He can go ahead and smoke that right rear, run her sideways, do whatever he wants, because he's got plenty of tires. Shouldn't blister unless he gets really, really crazy. Here he goes again. He slid right up there. Man, that was close. He almost caught the left rear of Bob Ciccone with his right front, but he just could not quite get up far enough.
Are these guys developing a rhythm in this race that they carry over to the feature?
Well, of course they are. They're more importantly than developing a rhythm, they're learning about their race car. They're learning what they have to do to make it a little bit faster. And that's the most important thing that's happening. Even though Jim Kinker's running quick, even though Bob Ciccone's running quick, I'm sure they're going to make some slight adjustments in order to run quicker in the main. Here we see.
Fourth, fifth, and sixth. That is Greg Staub now in the fourth position.
Gary Heber right behind him, Gary, and Trey House right behind him in fifth spot. Trey House is running very good in that 3-1 car. Kinker's still trying. He keeps trying and trying and trying.
Yeah, but how advantageous is it right now to run that close together and really take a chance of making contact and perhaps tearing up some equipment?
Well, like I said, really all he's doing is he's gaining one spot that he doesn't have to pass the guy in the feature. That's what he's after. And he can abuse the tire now where he cannot afford to do that in the main. So it might be advantageous to him to go ahead and abuse it.
Going into three.
The Ciccone doesn't give. He keeps sticking his nose in there.
But he slides up in front of him and slams the door as he comes down to complete lap number 19. Six laps to go. And Jim Kinker, we have seen him win in the midgets, like at Winchester a couple of weeks ago. We have seen him drive very well in the sprint cars.
Boy, look how far he got up in front of him right away.
Dave Despain, you've caught up with Danny Smith.
Indeed, and the offending part right down there, broken right rear suspension has put Danny Smith out of this race. Danny, what happened?
We ran about three or four laps, just kind of fifth or sixth there, and it started laying over on the right rear and started bottoming out. I knew they took 10. I was just kind of trying to stay in the hunt there and finish, and it got worse and worse. We just kind of, we got the 10th, we got the 11th, and one dropped out, and then finally the right rear birdcage broke, let the right rear corner fall down, so we're done.
Obviously, you had some warning. Was it exciting when it finally let go?
Well, I knew it was going to break. I just didn't know if we'd get to the checker before it broke. So I was prepared for it, and it let go, and I got it stopped in time and kept it out of the fence. So, yeah, it was a little thrilling there for a minute.
Okay, thank you, Danny Smith. Let's go back topside.
Well, as Kinker continues to pull away in the lead, we have had a position change in second. That is Steve Butler, a former Silver Crown champion, overhauling Bob Ciccone. He is up to second. Ciccone drops to third.
Yes, Butler did a fantastic job getting around him. He was one of the first guys to figure Raceway Park out after we started running here again a few years ago. There was a long time that USAC did not run Raceway Park. He came back, and he really figured it out quick, and he's got to figure it out pretty well tonight.
There is your leader, and he has a sizable gap right now. Jim Kinker should be able to coast the victory as they are working lap number 24 of this 25-lap Jonathan Bird qualifier. And there is the white flag coming out, 7th, 8th, and 9th down the backstretch. And there is the white flag for your leader, Jim Kinker.
It looks like
Tony Elliott
running 9th.
Tony Elliott and orange number 18 as they go back to the lead car, and Jim Kinker had a number of laps where he was attempting to get by Ciccone, and Ciccone looks like he's going to lose another position to Jim Kinker, or Kinker wins at the position.
Gary Heber.
No, Ciccone hangs on for third. Heber goes to fourth, and fifth would be Greg Staub, but Jim Kinker.
He really ran a good race. He really got that thing going. He once he got around Ciccone, he was just gone. He really looked like a nice, smooth job out there. And also, Butler did a fantastic job. He came from a little ways back there. He came from fourth starting position, ran second, and it was tough. Ciccone was running plenty fast. Those guys did a good job to get around him.
As we take a look now at the top 10, and these will transfer onto the 100-lap main event. Jim Kuiker, Butler, Saccone, Heber, and Staub. In the second five, we have
a qualifier's race, if you will, is complete. The top 10 have moved up, and this is a rain-delayed winter interview because I didn't get to talk to Jim Kuiker at Winchester in that rainstorm. First of all, congratulations for winning that one, buddy.
Thanks a lot, Dave. That was kind of like the winner of the Demolition Derby up there.
That was a survival test, wasn't it?
Sure was.
We're going to see some highlights of that a little later. Right now, I want to talk about tonight. Tell me about the job you had to do on Saccone there. He was tough to get around.
Yeah, Bob's, he and I have raced a lot side by side, and I trusted what he was going to do, and I think he trusted what I was going to do, and just took me a few laps, and we finally got by him.
How long before you actually made the move did you have it sort of sorted out in your mind and know what you wanted to do?
Oh, I knew I was going by him. I had to figure out some way to get back on TV.
Make up for that interview we missed. Now, of course, you got to go into the main event. You'll start 15th. A lot of guys in front of you. What are the prospects?
Try and pass about 15 of them.
No problem, right?
Yeah. Well, we'll see. Time will tell.
Congratulations on a good run, and good luck to you in the main event.
Thanks a lot, Dave.
All right, that is Jim Kuiker. Here's your top 10 as we head for a commercial, and we'll be back with more from Indianapolis Raceway Park. Jim Kuiker has won the qualifier to put himself in tonight's main event.
Watch out. Terminator 2, Judgment Day at a theater near you. And now, only at Subway, the Thirst Terminator Collector Cup. Filled with 32 ounces of your favorite soft drink. Get it with your favorite Subway sub. Oven fresh bread piled high with the freshest ingredients from just $1.69. Terminate your hunger. Terminate your thirst. With this summer's blockbuster hits only at Subway.
An earnest young singer named Headley interrupted his usual medley. A fire in my pants. Ooh, it feels like red ants. And it's leaving my crotch looking redly.
Pro-X kills jock itch fungus.
You're watching absolute proof of a simple fact. Oil and water don't mix. Which is why we make Olympic with pure linseed oil. To protect your home from the damage rain can do. Olympic stops the rain.
If it happens in baseball, you'll see it on ESPN.
There he goes. He leaps. He makes the catch.
See Tuesday night doubleheaders, Wednesday night excitement, Friday night twin bills, and exclusive Sunday night action.
The Los Angeles Dodgers are leading the National League West. The bionic arm of Oral Hershiser is back to its old dominating self. The Dodgers face the Braves live at 8 Eastern on ESPN Sunday Night Baseball.
Saturday Night Thunder back at Indianapolis Raceway Park. And before we go any further, I want to say hi to the guy who runs the place. Bob Daniels is hospitalized. Pancreatitis, I think they call it. And the guys here tell me that he not only has his remote control so he can keep it tuned to ESPN, but he also has the telephone right there by the bed. And guys, if he sees anything he doesn't like, he's going to be on the phone. Bob, get well quick. Bob Saccone is with us. And the last time we spoke, it was in the middle of a driving rainstorm at the aforementioned Winchester disaster. Tonight, what about this disaster in that qualifier race? What happened?
Dave, probably the people don't know, but we had problems early on. We had brake problems. The master cylinder wasn't right. We took time with no front brakes, and we had a shock absorber problem. We have a bit oscillation in the front that starts skipping. And the first half of the race, we were running really, really well. But then as the race went on, my tires got hotter, and they developed a bit oscillation. And it, I don't know if it shows on television, but the front end was skipping all through the corners. Luckily, Jim and Steve Butler are good drivers, and they saw my condition, and then they got real close. But they feel safe with me, and I'm safe with them. So it was a really good race, and happily for Jim and unhappily for me, he was hooked up.
That's a pretty long list of problems you got to solve here in time for the main event. Can you get them all fixed?
Absolutely. I certainly hope so, because a 100-lap race, but you just don't have time to. You can't nurse a race car for 70 or 75 laps, and we have to start in the back, so we have to be that much faster than everybody else to do well tonight.
Well, I appreciate you coming over here on a dead run to tell us all about everything that's wrong with that car. I guess we ought to let you get back there and get to work on it, huh?
Okay, I'd like to say hi to Bobby Daniels, because I know he feels bad.
Yeah, well, you take good care of that race car. We'll see you back in the main event, okay?
Will do. Thanks a lot, Dave.
All right, that's Bob Saccone as he discusses the handling problems that were giving him fits there in that qualifier. But he's in the main event, and he'll have time to try to get that baby fixed. And Larry Rice, I'd like to know more about that situation with Ciccone. Can you talk a little bit more about what he was having to deal with there?
Well, when you run a 100-lap race or any kind of a race car at this racetrack, when the front end is jumping around, what he's talking about, oscillation, he means the front end was jumping. It was actually skipping on him. And when you do that, you could see how tired he was. I mean, he was breathing pretty heavily for a fairly short race. You have to work so hard. A guy like him who is going backwards is working much, much harder than the guys that are going forward because their cars are handling so much better. He has to get that fixed because in a 100-lap race, it'll just flat wear him out.
I guarantee you, Ciccone's going to be hard at work on that car in this break before that 100-lapper that's up and coming. Look at the size of that crowd. And here's a guy that's definitely going to be a story here this evening. Larry Dixon, out of retirement again. I've lost track. I believe this is the third time back into action. It's a car driven or car built by his brother. Larry, one of the great names in the game. And our Larry Rice had a chance to get together with him and reminisce about old times and talk about the comeback.
USAC has a lot of full-time racers. Larry Dixon used to be one of those. But now he has apartments, he does carpentry work, a lot of other businesses. But he's trying to make a full comeback for the third time into USAC racing.
Larry still plans to work all day at his business, which is quite successful. After all, that's how he makes his living. But he would still like to recapture some of the fun that he had back in the 60s and 70s when flat tops and roll cages were still in vogue and broad sliding in the dirt was the order of the day. What are the biggest differences you've noticed since the last time you were a full-time competitor?
Engine and the money. The money is the biggest thing. It's hard for me to believe all the money that they spend, on engines and the chassis and all the trick stuff they have anymore. It's just, it's hard for me to believe that all this has taken place since I've been away from it, But it's still fun, and as long as my brother has the money to do it, but I'll drive for him. When he quits, I'm quitting.
Did you have a favorite track that you enjoyed most back then?
Reading, Pennsylvania.
Reading, Pennsylvania, long gone. What about the ones that are left? Any of those that stick out?
Winchester.
Winchester.
Winchester was my favorite. And I ran good at Winchester, and I guess that's the reason I liked it. And I'd go back there and run if I like to be competitive, but I don't want to run no sprint cars no more.
No matter how many years you race, you never forget a mistake where you get upside down, especially at a place like Eldora when roll cages didn't exist.
I can still feel it. It's I can see it. I talk about it every once in a while, but I guess, I qualified and I got the checkered flag and I ran down going into one, and the car got sideways and I thought I could correct it, and it kept going and it swapped ends, and just one of those things. I couldn't save it. Backed it up on the fence. Got upside down.
Larry Dixon versus Gary Bentenhausen was the original Gary and Larry show in the late 60s and early 70s, and their opinions didn't always agree.
I guess it wasn't a joke. One night at the fairgrounds, Gary was leading the race, and I passed him on the last lap or next to the last lap, and he says that at the time, he said, I ran him into the fence, and we laugh about it now and joke, and he said, I don't understand why you ran me into the fence, Dixon. And it's the first time I told him, or told Gary, I said, it's the first time that I've seen a guy leading a race and run into the inside fence and the other car never touched him. And Gary says, well, that's not how it happened. And Gary, he's got his own version and his own deal how this all happened. But we laugh about that, but others, we laugh about a lot of things that's happened between us.
What about tonight? Do you think we've got a real good chance here at Raceway Park this week?
I think so. If I don't get tired and fall out of the seat, I guess I got a good chance. The car is capable, more than capable, of winning a race. So I guess with a little luck, and now in racing there's so many cars that's equal that it's kind of hard to say, yeah, I got a real good chance. But I have a good chance of winning a race, and I'm going to give it a good shot. And I want everybody to know that I was there.
Well, I guarantee you, they're going to know he's here. There is Larry Dixon. That's the live shot from the pits as he prepares to go to work here tonight. Mentioned at the top of the show, a lot of great memories in tonight's show. That guy is one of the all-time greats, Larry Dixon. I don't think he's going to get tired and fall out of the seat tonight. He will be in the 100-lap main event that will be the highlight of tonight's Saturday Night Thunder. We continue our tradition here that we established for this season of showing you every lap of every race that runs and also reviewing what's happening elsewhere in the world of racing. What do you got for for me tonight, guys. Looks like GTP qualifying. They're up at Watkins Glen, Camel Continental. Porsche on the pole. How about it? John Winter, that, I believe, is the car that won Daytona with Chip Robinson alongside in the Nissan. The Chevy's very strong this year. Tommy Kendall will start third with Davy Jones, runner-up a week ago at the 24-hour of Le Mans, coming in fourth in qualifying today. Juan Manuel Fangio's grandfather celebrated his 80th birthday this week. He qualified fifth. Busch Grand National results at Watkins Glen today. Terry Labonte won the race from the pole with Joe Nemechek second. Ernie Irvin, the only Winston Cup driver represented up there in the head of the field. Jeff Burton was fourth. Todd Bodine fifth. And Jeff Gordon began another one of those wild days, finishing sixth in that race and then jumping in the airplane and screaming back here to Indianapolis Raceway Park to do battle here tonight in the Silver Crown car. So the 100-lapper is up and coming, and we invite you to stick around for that. Big crowd on hand for this bit of motorsports nostalgia, the Silver Crown cars from Indianapolis Raceway Park. We'll be right back. We're back live at Indianapolis Raceway Park, and we welcome you here to the Pepsi 100 for the USAC Silver Crown Cars field forming up here for tonight's main event. As we get set to turn them loose here, we've got upcoming USAC events to tell you about, and a bunch of them, too. Good-looking lineup of events here. July the 3rd, the holiday weekend, the National Sprint Series will be up in Marnie, Michigan. And the next race for these cars will be on August the 10th, the Silver Crown Series for the Coors Light Hoosier 100. That's their biggest race of the year, and that'll be just across town at the Indiana State Fairgrounds. So if you've got any reason at all to be in Indiana in the month of August, I suggest you try to check that one out. Indianapolis Raceway Park got the Hardy's Racing Series USAC Midgets next week, July the 6th, Saturday night. We, of course, will be here. August the 3rd is a biggie. NASCAR Busch Grand National cars coming here for the Kroger 200, and that is a thrill-a-minute show here on this big paved half-mile racetrack. Baseball, you bet. Got it tomorrow night. The L.A. Dodgers versus the Atlanta Braves. The Atlanta Braves actually are playing baseball in 1991. It's a refreshing change for those of us who live down in that neck of the woods. Here, of course, the emphasis is on motorsports competition, and we've got a great show for you tonight. But the neat thing that we get an opportunity to do tonight, we've been wanting to do this ever since we came back to Indiana, is kind of review how we got to where we are on Saturday Night Thunder. It's been a lot different season for us in our approach to covering the races. We kicked it off out at Ventura, California, on a little short dirt track, and I mean, we got off to a wild start. First race, first turn, first lap. Dale Sexton Jr. reminds us that even on the tiny dirt bull rings, racing is a dangerous game. It's a classic open wheel tangle. Opening night jitters certainly played a role. Cockpit integrity and helmet resilience were sternly tested. And a couple of weeks later, Dale was back on the show to tell us all about his new car. Opening night carnage also gobbled up a main event front runner. Terry Farrar walked away from this backstretch barrel roll and gave me a great interview, and then told me the following Saturday night he sure didn't remember a thing about being on ESPN. Why, even the legendary Sleepy Trip wound up on his head as he tried to tie the all-time record for USAC midget victories. Not everyone succumbed to rubber side up syndrome. A hotshot kid named Keith Roush in orange and the gnarly old veteran Hank Butcher put on the kind of show midget fans have been cheering for more than 60 years. The kid made the last pass and a star is born. Say hey to Colorado's Keith Roush, our first winner of the new season. Our second Saturday night began with this tangle between Tripp with that man in black paint job and Paige Jones, youngest son of Parnelli. But they were dramatically upstaged by Keith the Rim Rider Roush, who won my heart with these high side heroics. Now, if you pay close attention to racetrack crowds, you know they always cheer the loudest for the guy up top. And Roush was way up top. Takes a lot of courage and a lot of throttle to run up there. My advice to the youngsters is pass them on the outside. But do be aware of the potential consequences of your actions, as Roush learned the hard way in the main event. Passing on the outside is great, but remember rule number one, to finish first, you must first finish. Sleepy Trip took another shot at history, our second night at Ventura, but his chassis setup was a little wide of the mark. Naturally, he broke the record the week after we left. The star of show two was the hometown hero. Dennis Hart holds off Robbie Flock for the win. He lives 10 minutes from the track. That's called keeping the cash in the local economy, which, by the way, benefits a great deal from promoter Jim Naylor's Fairgrounds Raceway efforts. Jimmy Sills, the USAC Silver Crown champion, was the hero of Saturday night number three. Blow off Sleepy Trip and Keith Roush, and you're a legitimate fast guy. Here's Sills over Tripp in the main event. I love Jimmy's description of this racetrack. He called it, quote, a pretty racy little joint. And he was by far the raciest cat out there. The only interruption of Sills' runaway was Leland McSpadden's spectacular crash. The Tempe Tornado had the wind knocked out of his sails in an otherwise incident-free evening at the races. Then the speedy Mr. Sills picked up right where he left off, which is to say he left, checked out, split, and became our third winner in 3 weeks. Then came PJ. Contrary to what you may have heard, PJ Jones did not hit every car in the place our final night at Ventura. He only hit the fast guys, and he only hit him on his way past, headed for the front. This clout to the side of Sills' car, which gave PJ the lead, was unintentional but also uncalled for, and Jones was quick to apologize. He got the opportunity to do that shortly after climbing out of his own wrecked race car. PJ theorized that the contact with Sills cracked something in the front end, and when it eventually gave way, he went on his head. That left Sills to claim his second straight win while Robbie Flock was tops in our TV points. We came to California in search of sun, surf, and Saturday night thrills to whet the appetites of race fans still stuck in the cold weather. We left Ventura Fairgrounds Raceway with a lot of new friends and fond memories. You're right, Jimmy Sills. Pretty racy little joint. Indeed it was, and we certainly enjoyed our visit there. And Jimmy Sills, by the way, starts from the outside pole tonight in our Silver Crown feature. He's the defending division champion. I'd like to bring in Gary and Larry and have you guys reflect. Now, I know what Gary Lee's going to say here. He's going to tell me that his favorite memory of Ventura was that dwarf car race that he claims to have won. So let me rule that out right off the top. No talk about dwarf cars tonight. I would seriously, guys, like to know what your lingering memory of our visit to Ventura was.
That's all I was going to talk about. You left out the one highlight that I enjoyed the most, taking the checkered flag, dusting you guys off.
Well,
it's your turn now.
The thing I enjoyed most about the racetrack was the competitiveness. The racetrack was so competitive. Two grooves every night. Everybody could run every place on the racetrack if they knew how to set their race car up. And the fact that the drivers were so competitive. There were 15 guys there every night that had an honest shot to win. And they didn't mind banging on each other. They took it. They gave it out. They didn't complain. And it was great racing. I loved it, and I can't wait to go back.
Let me say, I was impressed with the job that Jim Naylor did, because we were there earlier. We saw the track condition a week before we actually raced. We thought, there's no way we're going to come out here and race. Naylor and the crew did what we didn't think they could do. And that's certainly a memory of the type of job, the type of track they presented for us.
Well, I think what they did there was only exhibited what the whole town did for us. They loved the racing. The drivers loved it. I think the fans loved it. And I think it's reflected in the way things went.
Well, what'd you like, Dave?
Well, aside from racing with you and the dwarfs, Gary, I had so many favorite moments, I couldn't pick one. I think my lingering memory of Ventura is not of a moment, but of a man. And that man is Sleepy Tripp and his four-night quest to try to tie Rich Vogler's all-time record for midget victories. He didn't get to do that on television, but in his efforts to do that, he certainly impressed me, and I think all of America, with his tenacity and his determination. And, of course, he did go on to tie and then break the record, and the mark now stands at 135. After Sleepy's most recent victory at Ventura. All in all, it was a great way to kick off the Saturday Night Thunder season. You may be wondering why we're looking at tape from Ventura here. Well, it's because it takes a little while to turn around those semi-final cars, but that's happening right now, and we're going to be back in just a moment at IRP.
At the first tickly itch of athlete's foot, get an X. Killing those grungy fungi before they get racket and burning. Go get that can now, or else don't blame Desinex.
Before you paint with a brush, consider the Wagner Power Painter. It has precision controls, a convenient backpack for big jobs, and it paints smoothly over cracks and tough surfaces. Wagner, not just a whole lot faster, a whole lot better.
All ready-to-serve orange juices start out equal. Most brands take out nature's water to form a concentrate, then put water back in. But here's one brand that doesn't. Tropicana Pure Premium. It's not made from concentrate. Nothing's ever added or taken away. In fact, no other major brand comes closer to this than this. Sooner or later, we think everyone will reach the same conclusion. You just can't pick a better juice.
You don't have to worry when rain keeps pouring down, 'cause your home can take it, whatever comes around.
Olympic Oil Stain has pure linseed oil. Since oil and water don't mix, it helps stop water damage.
It's no wonder we'll stop the rain.
Olympic stops the rain. All Olympic products are on sale now for a limited time at Sears.
The other day I get in my car, won't start. No small problem, right? Well, I figure it's the battery, so I go down to the AutoZone and I tell them what I need. The guy says to me, let's check your old one first. It might not be the problem. Turns out he was right. All I needed was a new battery cable. Talk about saving money. Now you tell me, would another parts store done that? They made sure I got exactly what I needed. Now I'll remember that. Believe me, I will.
The Pepsi 100, 100 laps for the USAC Silver Crown cars on tap tonight here at Indianapolis Raceway Park on Saturday Night Thunder. The 10 qualifiers from the semifinal are in the final stages of their preparation to go to the line to round out the 24-car field for tonight's feature. We mentioned that upcoming Kroger race here for the Grand National Stock Cars. The Kroger MS Challenge ran last week at Mid-Ohio, and who but our Gary Lee conned his way into another race car. Which one are you there, Gare?
Well, actually, I'm starting dead last in the Red Roof Inns number 41 because I was not there on Saturday for practice and qualifying as we get ready to take the green flag. Now, watch. I didn't jump the start, but I did get a good start.
Jump the start, right?
I'm just showing you versatility from winning on the dirt out in Ventura to racing speed roams at midgets to these cars.
Well, they gave that guy a slide job right there.
I didn't. Actually, these sponsors put up $6,000 to enter their driver for the weekend, with all the proceeds going to MS, multiple sclerosis. They made about $50,000 or $60,000 that weekend. 21 drivers in the race. We had a ball. I have to thank Red Roof Inns. They treated me like a real professional driver, and we actually started 21st.
What?
I hear you guys laughing about that now.
We know. We give Gary a rough time, but he did come from last to 10th, right? 10th
That's
place?
Right, 21st to 10th.
Well, that's not too bad for a rookie in those kind of cars.
Rookie in those kind of cars.
All right.
With very little practice. Because I was here with you last Saturday, I couldn't practice and qualify.
Okay. Well, we'll give him a little credit once in a while. I guess he deserves that much anyway.
I'm not giving him a bit of credit, except for the 60 grand. I mean, I'm glad there was a good excuse for letting him go out there and embarrass the rest of us like that.
Oh.
Gary Lee, off to the races. Seriously, it was a good effort for a good cause, and we appreciate Gary and everybody else being involved in that. Baseball Tonight follows us here on Saturday Night Thunder. All the scores and highlights from this afternoon and tonight's baseball action. This race has an interesting history. Take a look at the previous winners here. Rick Hood won the first one back in 85. Big names in there. Kenny Schrader, of course, now doing the Winston Cups. Jeff Bloom is here tonight. Bruce Field. Schrader's actually won it twice. And George Snyder through the semifinal to win it here last year. And he's back to try to do it again tonight as we come back for another 100 laps tonight. The race used to run 150 laps. Now it is 100 laps. We are back in the Midwest, and Larry Rice said it very well. We're leaving the beaches and headed for the cornfields, but by golly, there are cornfields. Let's look to the rest of the Saturday Night Thunder season. Saturday Night Thunder came back home to Indiana, and races like this are the reason we love Indianapolis Raceway Park. Stevie Reeves in White's a local hero with a great future. Pennsylvania's Bob Ciccone loves his racetracks paved, banked, and fast. Their lead-swapping battle had Lee and Rice at the top of the decibel range. Ciccone had the last word.
He was running really well. And just very, very slightly coming back to me. I started catching him towards the latter stages of the race, and I was able to pass him in one and two. And he really charged three and made a pass back. And I figured rather than stand my ground and maybe bump wheels with him, I would just let him use his momentum, let him go out. And I snuck under him. And like as Curly would say from the Three Stooges, I surrounded him.
All right. And a week later, we rode along with a winner, Gene Lee Gibson, second-generation racer out of Richwood, Ohio. He carried the Saturday Night Thunder onboard camera, and he gave that boy quite a ride. In fact, he rode it right into victory lane. Mid-May, High Bank Winchester Speedway. P.J. Jones comes back east, but collides with Mark Alderson in the heat race. First miscue in a long evening of frustration. But P.J.'s lucky. He could have been Chris Critter Malone. Critter touched wheels with Bev Griffiths and took a big league tumble. He walked away, but the car was history, and he's still on foot, left without a ride. The Winchester winners? Well, in the midget division, it was Indiana's own Stevie Reeves who put that Saturday Night Thunder on board camera in victory lane for the second week in a row. Here's the reason the locals all say this kid's got a great future in open-wheel cars. And first to the sprint car pay window, Robbie Stanley. He's raced Winchester twice, won them both. back to IRP and talk about onboard camera work. Take a look at Jeff Gordon in the thick of a lead battle with Bob Ciccone and Mike Fedorchuk. In the single wildest move of the Saturday Night Thunder season thus far, Gordon, two wheels down the backstretch, never took his foot off the floor and didn't even lose a position. Now that's entertainment, but Fedorchuk went on to win the race. And if you like three-car battles, well, you had to love our first sprint car show in the month of June. Watch Steve Butler zipping past Robbie Stanley and Johnny Parsons and taking the lead. The four-time USAC sprint car champions had a bad luck monkey riding on his back all season. When the checkered flag fell, Mr. Butler calmly kicked Mr. Monkey all the way into the cheap seats. It was an inspired victory for Steve Butler here at IRP. And now the stormy night we'll all remember. 2 weeks ago in Winchester, T-bone crash victim Don Schilling suffered a badly broken pelvis. Last Saturday night, he announced his retirement. And to end the evening as a rainstorm closed in, Bob Ciccone's tangle with Danny Drynan that sent Ciccone bouncing, tumbling, and flipping. A multi-car tangle that ended just as the rains began to pour down. And in that same crash, more amazing onboard camera pictures. Ride along with Steve Reeves as his car flips and tumbles, and he finishes his night in a downpour of fuel. Despite the massive destruction, there were no injuries. Even Ciccone's one-liners remained intact.
That's called a short field landing with no flaps, and that's it. That's what it's called.
And finally, Stan Fox, who sat out the first half of the midget season to concentrate on IndyCars, finished 8th in the 500 and came back here to win last Saturday night. And so if this is your first visit to Saturday Night Thunder, that's what you've missed. What you're going to see tonight is something unique, 100 laps for the Silver Crown cars back here at Indianapolis Raceway Park. Those guys are starting to strap themselves into the cockpits here and get ready to go. How about it, guys, up top? Any favorite IRP memories? Anything that sticks out in your minds here as we prepare for tonight's feature?
Dave, I think a combination of here at IRP and also out at Ventura is the fact that the Steve Lewis Performance Racing Team, the white number 9, they've won 4 races with 3 different drivers. Perhaps a team that tests the most is perhaps the best prepared. They've done a great job.
Yes, I think the thing that sticks out in my mind is the fact that I came back here kind of expecting a downer. I thought, geez, we've got to come back here. Those races in Ventura were so great. We're never going to be able to top that. But we came back here, and in fact, we have done as well, if not better, back here. The races have been fantastic back here on the pavement. Places that you're not supposed to be able to pass, they pass each other on every lap. That sticks in my mind more than anything.
Dave, how about you?
I would wholeheartedly second that opinion. It has been great racing here at IRP. My favorite moment has to be Gordon running up over the back wheel, getting 2 wheels up off the ground and still managing to hang on to that position. We may have a minute to talk to a couple of these guys here before they get ready to fire these things up and go racing. Stay with us live on Saturday Night Thunder.
Help celebrate the biggest Ford sales event of the year. It's Ford's Great American Parade of Values, going on now at your Ford dealer. Featuring America's best-built, best-selling cars and trucks, like America's design leader, Ford Taurus. Right now, get this Taurus GL with air, automatic, stereo cassette, power driver's seat, and plenty more. You'll save $1,450 from the factory. And that's before you make your best deal, where quality is standard. Your participating Ford dealer.
Insurance is puzzling sometimes, but your State Farm agent can put it all together for you. The best value in car insurance, low-cost coverage for your home, life insurance, coverage for your health. Everything fits together when all your family insurance needs are served by one person, your State Farm agent.
See one of your Lexington area State Farm agents, Grover Jones, Howard Shelton, Dick Perry.
Smoking. Find out who's cooking at the Camel Continental 8. Live from Watkins Glen, Sunday afternoon on ESPN.
You took a stand for all we stand for. You gave your hand when it falls.
You are the one who lifted us
You're the ones we thank you all.
Field of superstars getting set to go out here and do battle in this Silver Crown 100 lapper here tonight. And this guy is just about to be introduced as the defending champion in the race. He is, of course, George Snyder. And we heard his story at the top of the show coming through the semifinal last year. No such heroics this year, George, but what about the prospects for repeating here?
Well, I don't know. We're just going to try our best and hope we can come out on top again, but it'll be tough.
Last year was a very strategic race, saving the car and being best on the last lap, not the first 25 or 30 laps. Same story for tonight?
I believe so. Anytime you have to run a 100-lap race on a place like this, it's tough on tires, and you have to kind of baby them a little bit.
Name me the two guys you're most concerned about tonight. Who you got to beat?
I would say Jeff Gordon and Sills.
Jeff Gordon and Sills. That's a pretty good heavy-hitting pick. Good luck tonight.
Thank you.
I'm not going to let this guy get away. Right next door is Stan Fox, who won here a week ago tonight in the midget car, kind of the other end of the spectrum with the Silver Crown machine. What do you think, Stan? You got a shot at him?
Oh, I think so. The car felt real good qualifying, and we're always quick here. We're going to give her a good shot. Jeff Gordon and Sills, I don't know if George knows what's going on, but I think we're going to win it.
So I wondered, with you sitting right there off his left shoulder, how come he didn't pick you? What's the story?
I don't know what's the matter with him. I'll have to straighten him out when we go by, huh?
I've heard of that Sills and Gordon guy, but I don't think they're anything to talk about, are they?
Well, I brought Gordon Johncock down as an advisor tonight. I got a two-time 500 winner in the pits helping me out, and I'd like to say hi to Ron Hemmelgarten. He's up watching it up in Michigan. Hi, you guys.
Okay, man. Good luck tonight.
Thanks.
That is Stan Fox, along with our defending race champion, George Snyder, as we get set to strap him in and turn him loose for 100 laps at Indianapolis Raceway Park. Stay with us. We're live at Indy.
Say, kids, what time is it?
It's Kids Day Free Time at Quality Comfort Clarion and Sleep Hotels.
Huh? Kids 18 and under stay free at Choice Hotels when you call 1-800-4-CHOICE and reserve a room.
Linen, no better way to face the day.
The morning belongs to Skin Bracer Aftershave. Its cool, brisk tingle really gets you going. And what a great scent. Skin Bracer.
No better way to face the day. Find it.
It's one of the most technologically advanced, most rigorously tested fluids on Earth. Relentlessly measured for maximum protection against the friction, the wear and tear, the heat and stress of today's engines. It is today's Quaker State. In Europe, in Japan, in America, Quaker State quality has passed the most demanding tests automakers can throw at it. At Quaker State, we don't just say we're tough, we're tested tough. The big Q is one tough motor oil.
Saturday Night Thunder is being brought to you by Olympic, the family of products that protect your home from damage rain can do. Olympic stops the rain. By Dunlop Tires, Dunlop outperforms. And by Super 8 Motel, where beautiful mornings begin at 8.
Well, the guys are now strapping in only minutes before we push them off. And since 1971, the Silver Crown Division has been a separate series under the USAC banner. Guess what driver has started more of these races than any other? But he's not racing this evening because he's up here broadcasting 98 starts. He'll make 100 later this summer.
Well, it'd be nice if it was 98 wins, but we do have a lot of starts in these cars. These cars are very, very temperamental, but I enjoy them more than any other kind of racing I've ever done. Tonight, I think Jimmy Sills is going to be very tough. He is very, very competitive this year, probably his best year ever, even though he won the Silver Crown Division last year. Jeff Gordon, with that experience he's gained in the NASCAR cars, he's going to be awfully tough. But Parsons in that six-cylinder car has got to be a real favorite, too. I drove that car last year. It is really, really fast on the pavement.
But in racing, you're only as good as your last race, and a winner here in this race in the past, Jeff Bloom, will be a spectator. He didn't make the show this evening.
That's right, and it's tough to make the race. But we're not going to go down to Dave now. I think he's got something to say with Jeff Gordon.
Well, indeed, let's check in on the latest episodes of the flights of Air Gordon. It flew in today from up at Watkins Glen, New York, 16th to 6th in the Grand National Road Race today. Congratulations.
Thanks a lot. You know, everything went really well. We hung in there just like we wanted to. We wanted to just finish the whole thing out. Ended up 6th, you know, top 10. That's super.
Tell me about qualifying here. I saw you come running in, hurdle the fence, jump in the car, no practice, and then what?
Well, you know, it's really tough to be able to do that, but when you got a crew like these guys, you really can trust them. And I just really got to thank Rusty Rasmussen for getting in it and practicing all day and getting the car dialed in for me. And Bob East for building the super race car. You know, this thing's really fast. And, you know, we're doing really well. We've won two races so far. We're going to try to win this one. I just want to say one thing about the Coors Light A.J. Foyt Hoosier Hunter that's coming up here in August. I'm really looking forward to that. And, you know, we're just going to try to win this one tonight.
Okay, man, good luck to you.
Thank you very much.
He's going to get strapped in and go to work for the second time today. Jeff Gordon, series point leader in the Silver Crown cars. We'll be back to fire him up right after this.
You don't have to worry when rain keeps pouring down, because your home can take it.
Olympic Oil Stain has pure linseed oil. Since oil and water don't mix, it helps stop water damage.
It's no wonder we'll stop the rain.
Olympic stops the rain. All Olympic products are on sale now for a limited time at Sears.
Performance Car, one of Europe's leading automotive magazines, put tires to the test. Dunlop's D40 M2 beat the best. Seven world-class tires went through 14 rigorous tests in the ultimate performance challenge. When the results were in, the winner was Dunlop. Outpacing, outscoring, outperforming six of the world's best tires. Read it and believe it. Call 1-800-845-TEST. Dunlop outperforms.
Whose romance with the road is rekindled with each sunrise. Beautiful mornings begin at 8. Super 8 Motels.
Hey, everybody, let's go. We asked these experts on summer and dad to help introduce the new Master Values program. Now get 10 to 25% off summer stuff only with MasterCard. From getaway gear and luggage at Kmart to home decorating needs at Color Tile, to tapes and CDs at Camelot Music, and more. Then watch the savings pile up. Look for Master Values only from MasterCard at these and other fine stores. And master the moment.
We're back at Indianapolis Raceway Park, and Jim Kuecker is just now attempting to fire up, and he's back here on the back side of the pits. The problem is a seal behind the water pump. They had to replace it, and then it became a real thrash to get that done in time for the main. But the car has fired, and so the man who just a few minutes ago won the semifinal here will, in fact, be able to roll out and assume his 15th starting spot on the starting lineup here for Jim Kuecker. And I'll tell you what, that was a white knuckler. They just did get it finished, and he's going to be in the race. So let's go back up topside to Gary and Larry, guys.
Talk about the frustration in the cockpit when something goes wrong. He had a good ride in that semi, transferred to the main event, and then there was a possibility he wouldn't race.
Well, you do get very frustrated. You get very anxious. I think the nerves are the biggest factor in a race like this. You're so much anticipating what's going to happen. That's a little longer race. You're trying to figure out exactly how you want to run it. And then when something like that comes along, it kind of distracts you a little bit, and it slows down your thinking process as to what you should be doing during a race.
Well, once again, the veteran Johnny Parsons will be starting from the front row. We're starting straight up. The faster qualifiers, at least the first 14 fast qualifiers, are starting straight up with JP in the front row alongside defending Silver Crown champion Jimmy Sills. So we had a couple of real veterans up there. We've talked all evening about the youth and the age as we got a good in-car camera shot, the CarQuest cage cam, as we ride along with car number 81, and that is the young Eric Gordon.
Yes, and if he gives us shots like that all night, we will take a nice ride tonight.
Well, let's take a look now at the starting lineup for the Pepsi-Cola 100 from Indianapolis Raceway Park. We are live here on Saturday Night Thunder. And in the front row, the yellow number 20, that's the V6 of Johnny Parsons. Alongside is the Bob Consani-owned Pioneer Concrete number 1 of Jimmy Sills.
And in the second row, on the inside, there's the guy who has won the only two outings in these cars this season, the M&L Plumbing Beast of Jeff Gordon, and Stan Fox alongside. That's the Jack Tool Reynolds number 9. Wally Pankratz comes in from California. He'll start inside row 3 from Greenfield, Indiana. Eric Gordon outside in 81. In the fourth row, on the inside, there's your winner from 1 year ago, George Snyder, and outside, a former midget champion, Russ Gamester in 85. In the fifth row, on the inside, Chuck Gurney in 29, a former Silver Crown champion, and Gene Lee Gibson in the Aristocrat number 8. In the sixth row, Steve Chassie in car number 69, outside, the youngster from nearby Brownsburg, Indiana, Robbie Stanley in 74. In the seventh row, on the inside, Andy Hillenberg in car number 12, and outside, a three-time USAC sprint car champion, Larry Dixon in number 73. In the eighth row, Jim Keeker, the winner of the semi. These are all drivers that transferred from the semi. And a four-time USAC sprint car champion, former Silver Crown winner, Steve Butler in number 10. In the ninth row, we have Bob Ciccone in number 59 and Gary Heber in 6. In the 10th row, on the inside, Greg Staub in number 44 and Trey House, the youngster from nearby Chesterton, in number 31. In the 11th row, Tony Elliott in number 18, Mike Fedorchek, the veteran from Fort Wayne, Indiana, making his first ever Silver Crown start in number 92. Then it's Jerry Niemeyer in 98 and Brad Marvel in 90, comprising row 12. 24 cars, 100 laps. The yellow will count once again. This is a race of patience. That may sound a little disconcerting to a race fan, but you have to use patience here.
Sometimes you do have to use a lot of patience, and especially in a race like this. You don't want to get anxious. You don't want to burn the tires up too early. The guys who go out there and try to really go fast and pass 10 or 12 cars in the first 5 laps are going to find themselves sorely in need of that fresh tire come 20 or 25 laps into the race.
Johnny Parsons, the Nibel built chassis with a V6 power plant, he has a weight advantage. You think perhaps you'll let somebody else lead the race?
Yeah, I don't know. He probably will. I think John's going to be very patient. Here goes the start. Sills jump right out of the
crew. Sills gets the lead. There's Stan Fox in the other red number 9, and he's in fourth position. Gordon rides in third, down the backstretch. It's Sills leading in a coil car. That's a coil beast that set a track record in his debut ride in the Copper Classic back in Phoenix in February. He leads. Johnny Parsons, Nibelbilt V6, rides in second. Jeff Gordon now is third, and fourth is Stan Fox. No, Stan is now riding in fifth position.
That's Wally Pankratz running fourth, Gary. He jumped into fourth position on the very start. Look at everybody. They're using a little patience. They're just following each other. They're not getting in any real big hurry. They want to make sure they've got their race car nice and smooth. Look at this in-car camera shot. Look at everybody. That nice long file. Looks like a NASCAR race. Everybody right in line, going right down the straightaway.
Well, as we look at the groove, and he kind of straddles that white line going through turn number 1 and then slides up a little and off the corner and down the backstretch.
Well, when he runs a racetrack like that, he's having a little bit of a pushing problem, which is probably good at this point in the race. You want the race car to be pushing at this point in the race because all that fuel is behind you. If it's not pushing now, later on, it's going to be very, very loose.
Well, as we look back behind him now, there is Russ Gamester in car number 85. Russ Gamester, a former USAC National Midget Champion, making a very rare appearance in the Silver Crown cars. Doesn't have a lot of experience in these cars.
Right, you saw that left front on his car lift up just a little bit as he turned the wheel. With all that weight behind you, it's very easy to lift that left front off the ground if you're not watching and not running very straight.
Look who's up to second position. Jeff Gordon goes to second, and Johnny Parsons now being battled for third position, so JP may be very content to let somebody else set the pace early and he can ride back there in fourth or fifth.
I think JP knows exactly what he's doing. That's Wally Pankratz in that red car underneath him. He's trying pretty hard, but he's doing a lot of wiggling around when he does that. He doesn't want to use that tire this early. I know he said that about Snyder last year, and he proved me wrong by coming along and winning the race, but you have to be somewhat conservative. Stan Fox is right there in the second red car also, very, very close to him.
Snyder now rides in the sixth position in the black Skoal 11 car. He started 16th last year, so it is possible to win from back in the pack.
Yeah, look at this. A very tight bunch. Here we see Fox. We see he's in that second red car.
Right there. Car, it looks like it's into the wall, and that is your defending champion, George Snyder, in the Skoal number 11. And that is a car that he co-owns with his buddy, Supertex A.J. Foyt, and he is in the wall. That brings out the yellow. Once again, these yellows will count. This will conserve fuel and tires.
Bad luck for Snyder. Something broke on that race car before he ever entered the corner. We saw sparks flying out of the back just as the camera went off of him, and the race car went straight into the fence. I'm not sure exactly what happened. Right there, he can't get his neck strap off. He's still fastened to the neck strap, which was going to hold his head up while he was in the race car. He's trying to get out of there, but that thing seems to be stuck. I don't know what could be stuck on him. A lot of times they have radios in the Indy cars, and they sometimes get stuck. But I don't think they're allowed the radios. He just can't get. He must have some kind of a mechanism attached to the car to keep his head up. And then your head gets very, very heavy in this race. You know, a lot of G's, a lot of pull, so you have to have some method of holding your head up, and that appears to be why he's having trouble getting his helmet off right now.
Well, now he's going to extricate himself from the cockpit. All right, now watch the last car in your frame, the black number 11. This is Snyder. This is coming off the fourth corner, down the front straightaway. Now, let's see if we can pick up exactly what happens, if there's a contact with another car, or perhaps something does break.
Everything seemed to be fine. He's going into the corner. He's on the outside of the car in there. Look, the left rear. Something dropped on the left rear. It looked like the left rear suspension broke, and he just went straight into the fence. That left rear dropped down, just drove him right straight into the fence. He didn't have a chance to turn the car.
But was there contact there with Fox before he went off to the fence?
I don't think so.
Well, here's from the in car, and let's take a look from the in car. Well, you can't tell if there's contact there, but obviously you can see the sparks. He's totally lost control. He's a passenger at this point as he goes right to the wall.
Sparks are coming out of the left rear. I don't know whether it could have been a steering arm up in front of the left rear. We couldn't see exactly where it was, but something on the left side of the race car broke, and it just drove him straight into the fence.
Well, we continue to run under the yellow. The yellows do count because we have 100 laps, but the yellows will count here from Indianapolis Raceway Park. Obviously, some fluid on the track as Jimmy Sills continues to lead over Gordon, Parsons, Pankratz, and Stan Fox.
Lexington's newest supermarket is brimming with grand opening bargains, free samples, prizes, and more. Come see the new Heartland Village Food Town store in the Tate's Creek Man of War area. You're gonna love it.
Hey, Bob, did you want to be a doctor when you were little?
Well,
you would have been the best doctor, Grandpa.
Oh, you think so?
It's too late for some dreams, but not for others.
Every year around this time, all across America, we prepare to celebrate our nation's freedom and independence. We'll have parades, fireworks, picnics, family and friends together. But this year on the 4th, we'll be giving a special salute to honor our past and present servicemen and women, those who protect our land of the free and our home of the brave. Thanks to all of them, and a memorable 4th of July to you, America.
Then jump into some wet and wild fun. Leave your worries behind. Chill out with ESPN's Hot Summer Nights. Mondays on the Totally Hot Sports Network.
Well, this Pepsi-Cola 100 will not have a repeat winner. The videotape may not make it clear what happened up here in turn one, but George Snyder, I think, has a very clear opinion. I saw you pointing at the red number 9. What happened?
Well, Stanley was fighting with a couple other guys there, and I had a chance to go around him on the outside. I don't know if he saw me or not, but he moved up on me and slammed me in the fence.
So he basically moved into you and left you know where to go?
Yeah, you got it.
Did he have an alternative in your mind?
I was really watching in between there. I wasn't paying much attention to the guys he was fighting there with. I just saw an opening and went for it, and it closed up.
Can you give me a thumbnail on what the conversation with Stan Fox will be after the race is over?
It'll all blow over.
Okay. Well, he's not happy, but he is out of the race. George Snyder hit by Stan Fox in turn one.
Larry, there's a situation where he said, I found an opening, I went for it. That is a race driver. That's what you do in a race. But there again, second thoughts. Bench racing and say, well, maybe I should have waited a later in the race.
Well, I think George, he's been around a long time. He's not going to second-guess himself. He did exactly what he thought was right at the time. It didn't work out, and like he said, it's over with now. He's going to go on to the next race, and it'll do better the next time. But, maybe he wishes at this point he hadn't gone in there. But it's racing. You've got to do what you think at the moment. That's the only way you get ahead in this game.
We're about to go back to green. Up in front, Jimmy Sill. Second is Jeff Gordon. And these two saw a lot of each other at the Indiana State Fairgrounds back in May because Gordon won it and Sills finished second. Good battle for second position. Those Parsons had a look to the inside as they restarted this race.
Now, those are very fast race cars. They have been all year. All three of those cars up front have been all very, very quick the last two or three years. And it's going to be, again, those three guys that are battling for the front.
Stan Fox slowing down the backstretch. Perhaps that contact may have damaged the Beast number 9, the Jack Tool rental car of Stan Fox.
Very well could be. Oh, we got more trouble up here in the front.
That's Consigny's car. That's the Pioneer Concrete number 1. That's Jimmy Sills.
Man, they're dropping out of here like flies. Everything's going wrong all of a sudden to everybody. I can't believe it. Our 3 or 4 of the best cars here have all had trouble. Just bang, bang, bang. And it's left who in front? Jeff Gordon.
Well, Jeff Gordon out in front in the M&L Plumbing. And once again, he starts to open up a bit of a gap over Johnny Parsons. But I would have to believe that Johnny will say, hey, I think I'll let him go ahead and run.
Yeah, I think that John's running his race. He knows as long as he's inside, as long as he's running quick, he knows how fast he can run. He's running a little bit softer tire on that V6 because it's a lighter car and he can get away with it. They allow the V6 because it's smaller in cubic inches, have a lighter car, therefore they have a softer tire on the right rear.
Here's what it looks like to ride in fourth position with Eric Gordon, the CarQuest cage cam, down the back stretch of this 0.68 mile. And there's Larry Dixon in the white and red number 73. He moves into ninth position. He qualified, what, 14th here this
season? Yes, he did.
Larry Dixon, a 3-time USAC sprint car champion.
Running very, very good. He looks like he hasn't been away from this sport for 10 years when he runs like that. He's passing cars and going forward. That guy's been a race car driver his whole life. He just took a little time off, that's all.
Well, I don't think there's any question or concern about him falling out of the saddle this evening. He can go the distance. If that car hangs on, he'll hang on.
He has the determination. That's one of the major factors in a race car driver. You have to have the determination to do it. And he does have that factor, and it's going to make him a competitor no matter what he runs, where he runs, or when he runs.
Well, you know, one thing about Lightning Larry Dixon, he has had successful returns. Not many drivers walk away from the sport, then come back with success.
Well, when he came back the first time, they said that he was too old, but he came back and proved them wrong. Here we see Russ Gamester again, following, who's he following? Eric Gordon.
Eric Gordon, still number 81.
And he's trying to work on him. He's been trying to sneak down under him ever since the race started, but he just doesn't seem to be able to get down there. He gets in there low, but he can't make a stick and go around it.
Well, and also, there are a number of tire compounds these drivers can use, between Hoosiers and Goodyears. So obviously these cars may not come into the best handling until lap 60 or 70.
Most of these guys depend on the tire companies. They're about evenly split between Hoosiers and Goodyears. They depend on the company to tell them what is going to be the best tire. Both companies have been out here. They've tested a lot. They know what their tires will do, so they've recommended tires. Most of these guys have gone with the recommended tire. There may be some who have gone with a little softer or harder tire just to be safe, but most of them have what the company recommends.
But you say they build in the push early to make the car handle late. I think we have some comments now from Jimmy Sills as to what may have put the number one car out.
Let's ask him. Jimmy Sills, the defending champion in this series, what happened?
Broke some gears in the rear end, either quick change gears or maybe the ring and pinion. I just went into turn 3 and that motor started pre-whining, and just I could hear something rattling in the back.
Did you get a chance in the time you ran to tell us who's going to be tough to beat?
I think Jeff Gordon's probably going to be real tough tonight.
Okay, man, sorry to see you out of it. He says Jeff Gordon may be the guy to beat. Jimmy Sills is out for tonight.
Well, there's a look at the good battle right now as we go back to Johnny Parsons in the number 20 car, the yellow number 20. That's the V6 power plant, and then the number 56 of Wally Pancrest. We talk about the young and old, a couple of real veterans there. A
couple of real veterans, and of course, they're trying to catch Jeff Gordon, who's way out front. He's one of the new guys. But these guys are running pretty good races. They know exactly what they're doing, where they're at. They're trying to run the line that saves the tires. I don't think they're concerned at this point in the race. If Jeff gets way out in front of them, gets away, and there aren't any more yellows, they may be in trouble. But I think they're pretty happy right now.
Gordon right now is 2.4 seconds out in front of these two drivers right now. That's really a big lead for this early in what we're calling a long race.
Well, it is a pretty big lead, but like I said, I don't think they're too concerned. They know they're pretty quick. They know they're running pretty fast, as Bob Ciccone pulled in the pits. They're pretty happy. They're going to run their race, their tires. They're going to wait for another yellow. Here's Ciccone. We see him pulling in the pits. We don't know exactly what happened to him, but he just kind of coasted in there.
Ciccone is such a crowd favorite. I think probably he and Jeff Gordon got the biggest round of applause when they were introduced. He always has a quip. Good luck, bad luck. When he had that terrible grinding crash at Winchester, he was quick with the quip.
He jumps out and starts talking about airplane landings. I'll tell you, he is fast. He's a neat guy, and I'm sorry to see him out of this race.
Larry, a lot of drivers will make a comment about a race coming back to them. Talk about that, if you will. Right now, we see Jeff pulling out to a very large lead, but ideally, these drivers are being patient, letting the race come back to them.
Well, that's exactly right. A guy who jumps out to the lead. Here we see Steve Butler. He's just gone around Andy Hillenburg, made a real good move. He's moved a long way up in that 10 car. He went around Andy Hillenburg. He seems to be working very, very well. But a lot of the guys who are running second, third, fourth, fifth, they are waiting. A lot of times there'll be a rabbit, a guy that'll jump out and run really quick. A few years ago, Rich Vogler went out, led the race. He led it by half a lap, real, real quick. And everybody thought he's gone. But he wore the right rear tire out. He wore it out, had to come in and make a pit stop.
Well, let's look at the margin now between first and second and on back to third. Jeff Gordon enjoying over a 3.3-second lead as a slower car now between. And there is Johnny Parsons in second, the yellow number 20. That's the V6 power plant. He is in second, and there is the gap back to the red 56 of third. Well, there's a good look at Larry Dixon.
That's Steve Chassie. He's following. That's Steve Chassie that smoked the tire going in there, and Jimmy Keeker is moving up around both of them. He's going very well. Dixon in the 73 car, Keeker in the 3 car, and Steve Chassie in that 69 car. All running very, very well, but Keeker
has the major. I'm impressed with Keeker.
I'll tell you what, he is doing an excellent job. He found out a few things in that semi. He found out, look at the wheel. It's not up in the air like it was in the semi. We talked about how he was carrying that wheel. He got the chassis settled down, and he's made that semi pay off for him.
Well, let's go down and check with Bob Ciccone. Dave, what was his problem?
Well, let's ask him. Bob, you told us the long list of problems you had during the break. Was it one of those that finally got you?
Exactly, Dave. The front end started to oscillate again. And when that happened, it moved the pucks. I had no brakes, and the front was uncontrollable. I had to bring it in.
Was that something you worked on during the break to try to solve?
Definitely. They changed the suspension. They changed the shock absorbers. We thought it would help us out, but it didn't do anything. It just came back again.
Can anybody do anything with Jeff Gordon?
Can somebody?
I say, can anybody do anything with him tonight?
It's a 100-lap race, and it's pretty early in the race, so time is going to tell.
So Cody says it isn't over till it's over. Back upstairs.
Gordon continues to lead now on lap 32. Once again, it is a long race, so we have to do what we don't normally like to do and take a break. We'll come back with all the action. Of course, there's a look from our in-car camera, and we take a look at the top five. It is Gordon, Parsons, Pankratz, Gordon, and Russ Gamester. Coming back with more from Raceway Park.
You're watching absolute proof of a simple fact. Oil and water don't mix, which is why we make Olympic with pure linseed oil to protect your home from the damage rain can do.
Stop the rain.
Olympic stops the rain.
With Matchlight, you get the best charcoal, Kingsford, with just the right amount of lighter fluid already added. That's why there's only one match for Matchlight from Kingsford.
Brett Bodine, one tough driver, talks about Quaker State, one tough motor oil.
At North Wilkesboro, that Carolina asphalt was hot enough to fry our King Racing Buick. Our engine was running hot, 240 degrees, and I had to keep pushing it over 8,000 RPM. Now that's when you start worrying about your oil's viscosity breaking down. But when the going got tough, the same Quaker State you can buy right off the shelf was tough enough to get me to the finish line first.
Quaker State is one tough motor oil.
USAC, the most diversified sanctioning body in auto racing, sanctions the Indianapolis 500-mile race for the 36th consecutive year in 1991 as part of a racing schedule involving over 150 exciting events. Having already awarded over $100 million in total prizes, USAC is bigger and better than ever. Become a part of the excitement. Write for more information about membership in the United States Auto Club. Don't miss another exciting lap. Be there when the next green flag waves.
We are back live at Indianapolis Raceway Park. A pack right there as we continue the Pepsi-Cola 100 as Jeff Gordon in that white number 4 now finds himself in heavy traffic.
He sure does. That's Trey House in that 3-1 car on the outside, the yellow car on the outside. Tony Elliott right in front of him on the left. He's boxed in. There's no place to go. Here Tony Elliott moves down. He's going to give him room to go through there. Very nice gesture by Tony Elliott. He didn't have to move down that far to give Jeff room, but Jeff couldn't take advantage of it, it didn't look like.
Well, the move over flag was displayed, the courtesy flag, so those drivers know that one of the leaders is right there, and indeed, Jeff is having trouble getting through.
Well, he wants to make sure when he goes around him, he doesn't use the tire up. He wants to get around him as quickly as he can without doing anything silly. So he's happened to follow Tony Elliott and Trey House while they're running side by side.
But look at Parsons. Parsons has used this traffic to his advantage. He closes in. He takes a look to the inside. We're going to have a pass for the lead. Can he do it?
I think he can. That lighter car has its advantage in the traffic like this. He can run in place.
Oh, there's contact between Trey House and Gordon, and there's Parsons almost getting into it.
Parsons almost hit Gordon that time. That's real, real close. He's wanting that lead awfully, awfully bad for this early in the race. I didn't think he'd charge that hard, but man, he wants that lead bad.
Well, obviously, young Jeff was boxed in. The wily veteran Parsons knew it. He took advantage, and now he has the lead. Dropping Gordon to second. He pulls up behind and goes to the inside of Elliott. Can't make the pass, though, going into three.
You know, these cars are very equal. Even these guys that are getting lapped are running very, very quick. You know, they're running 120, 130 miles an hour around here, so the guys that are leading have to take a chance. They have to do something silly. A little fly job like Parsons did right up in front of him takes a group away.
But keep in mind now, although the courtesy flag was displayed, the move over flag, these guys were racing in their own pack for position. They don't want to back out and let somebody else go by. Good battle for position right here with Pancras and Russ Gamester, and Gamester is having an excellent ride this evening.
I think Pancras is having the problem we talked about earlier. He didn't have enough push in the car, so now the car is loose. The longer the race goes, the looser the car gets. He keeps going backwards and backwards and backwards. It felt real comfortable at first. He was passing cars, but the longer it goes, the worse that loose condition is going to get, and the slower he's going to have to go.
Looks like Robbie Stanley, number 74, has pulled the dirt car off the pavement, and he is up the competition. It's very difficult to see a dirt car. That's what we've called these cars for so many years, but they're so competitive on the paint tracks.
They certainly are. Jeff Gordon seems to be having an awful lot of trouble back there. Because we see Parsons, he's out front. He's riding high right now. He's doing good and just smiling and styling there going out front. But this is a great battle right here. I've been watching this off camera. Chuck Gurney in that 29 car, Jimmy Keeker in that 3 car. The 29 car is the car that Kenny Schrader has had so much success here. That car has won 2 races here, very successful. Chuck Gurney is a very good race car driver, but Jim Keeker has snuck up on him and is working on him real hard trying to get around. But he's not quite as close now as he was a couple of laps ago.
Well, Parsons in car number 20 going by Andy Hillenburg in the Holt Delrose number 12, the First National Bank of Terre Haute special, and pulls up behind the aristocrat car of Gene Lee Gibson. Right now, it appears that Johnny, if you want to use an old trot expression, is in the catbird seat. He has a very light race car because of the V6 and the weight advantage, and he's out front right now. He can go without abusing that right rear.
Obviously, he and his mechanic, Glenn Nibel, have got that race car set up very well. I ran that race car last year to race up in Milwaukee. I went third to last place before coming third back up to fourth. John was content to fall back to second place, third place, and not abuse his tire, but then when he had his chance, he went up. We're looking at a lap time now. That's John up there on the corner of your screen. We're going to get a lap time on him, see how quick he's actually running. But I think he's running pretty quick right now, 21, 22, 22.6.
Very good lap for this point in the race.
Hey, we're almost halfway through. Lap 48, he's running 22.6. They only qualified in the low 21, so that's very, very fast for this point in the race, believe me.
Well, Robbie Stanley, we have seen him win here on ESPN, and he is standing by now out of the race with Dave Spain.
Hey, this race has not been kind to Saturday Night Thunder winners. Ciccone's out, Sills is out, now Robbie Stanley. Robbie, what happened?
Well, we lost our power steering at about the 5th lap, and, you know, I thought, man, I'll hang with her all the way. There was no way I could hang with her anymore. You know, I was kind of getting the guys away. I saw the leaders come up, and as soon as I saw the leaders go by, I said, that's enough, you know, let them guys race.
Can you describe to me what it's like to try to drive one of those things without the power steering?
No way. Yeah, you can't do it. You know, on dirt, sometimes you can get away with it, but there's so much tire, so much bite with these tires, and these long corners and IRP are in them so long, that right front tire is bearing the ground so hard. So not much sense trying.
Robbie Stanley, wisdom is the better part of valor. He's out of it for tonight. Back to the booth.
Well, as we talk about Parsons and his ride, the two Gordons have swapped positions, and I mean that at the halfway point, that is Eric Gordon now up to second. Jeff Gordon runs the third. Eric in the white 81.
Well, I think, Gary, we're seeing exactly what we talked about. If you don't have your car set up right for the first of the race, it's not going to be as quick as the last of the race. We've seen Wally Pancras first start out very, very quickly, go forward and then go straight backwards after the race car got loose on him. And I think Jeff Gordon is experiencing the same problem. I think they missed the setup slightly, had the race car very quick at the beginning, but as the fuel went away and the back end lightened up, as that got lighter back there, it started getting loose, and he's just going backwards slightly, slowly, but surely as the race goes along.
let's see if we can pick up perhaps a lap time on Jeff Gordon to indicate if there is perhaps a problem with the tire or the engine, just the general chassis setup, because he went from that almost 4-second lead, lost it in traffic, now he's back to third.
He's still running that race car so smooth that you can't tell whether it's loose or not. But
Did I see some smoke
yeah.
right there?
Yeah. He is a little loose. Might be some smoke that might be getting on the right rear tire that might be causing it to get a little loose. But he doesn't have much straightaway speed either. You see, Gary Heber,
six car.
Really gained a couple of car lengths on him. He could have lost his brakes. That might be the reason he's going into the corner so easily.
Well, let's draw a comparison now. About a second slower than what Johnny Parsons is running out in the lead. So obviously there is a problem with that number four car, the ML Plumbing Beast of Jeff Gordon.
Yeah, he's running that thing as absolutely straight as he can under the conditions, but the conditions aren't going to allow him to go any faster than he's going right now. I think that red car that's sneaking up on him right there could be Russ Gamster, is it not?
That is Russ Gamster in car number 85. Jeff has to be a tired pup. It was hot and humid up at Watkins Glen today. He wrestled a 3,000-pound stock car over that road course, flew in here. He has to be tired, and now obviously he has a car that is perhaps not handling. Let's take a look now at the top five as we are going to go to another break as the race continues here at Indianapolis Raceway Park. Johnny Parsons is out in front with the youngster Eric Gordon is second. Then it's Jeff, Russ Gamster, Jim Kuecker, 56 and 100 laps.
Before you paint with a brush, consider the Wagner Power Painter. It has precision control, a convenient backpack for big jobs, and it paints smoothly over cracks and tough surfaces. Wagner. Not just a whole lot faster, a whole lot better.
At the first tickly itch of athlete's foot, Gantanex. Killing those grungy fungi before they get racket and burning. Go get that can now, or else don't blame Gantanex.
Same make, same model.
You just can't go around killing people.
New mission.
Come with me if you want to live.
Now he's mankind's last hope.
We gotta stick together.
Of stopping the future's ultimate weapon.
He's a Terminator like you.
Not like me.
Arnold Schwarzenegger. Terminator 2. Judgment Day.
Rated R. Special late night showings Tuesday. Starts Wednesday nationwide.
Couple of hot pitches going tonight in Major League Baseball. On SportsCenter at 11:30, will Scott Erickson win his 13th? Will Tom Glavin win his 12th? And will Jimmy Connors win his 100th singles match at Wimbledon? Find out on SportsCenter, 11:30 Eastern Time.
Back live at Indianapolis Raceway Park as we watch the leader, Johnny Parsons, continue to set the pace in that V6 number 20 as we look back to the interval between first and second. And there is Eric Gordon, who rides in second position. And Kuecker, Jim Kuecker, in that black number 3, a Jack Stout car. What a drive he's had. He started, 15th position? He's up to third.
We could see a repeat of last year when the winner came out of the semi in a black car. Only this year, it could be Jim Kuecker. He is really going quick.
Obviously, they made some chassis adjustments to that car between the semi that he won and the feature. Dave DeSpain, we have kept you busy down there in the pit area. An update on perhaps what's wrong with Jeff Gordon.
That's been the question on my mind. We'll put that question to Fred Heed. Any idea, Fred, what's wrong with Jeff's car?
Not at the present right now. It's something wrong with the motor, and we don't know exactly what it is at the present time.
You got any theories about whether it'll last?
We're hoping so. We're riding the Honda, the point championship, and we're just going to try to salvage what we can out of this race and go on to the Hoosier 100.
Fred Heed just trying to stay alive out here. Meanwhile, I've got Stan Fox with me. Stan was involved in that incident in turn one. George Snyder said you ran into him. Is that the straight scoop?
I'll have to see it on the video. I never really saw him from my point in the car until I just felt a bump, and he was quite a way. You know, I think he was behind me, hit my right rear. Eventually, I broke the radius rod in the car, and that's why we're...
You had your own battle going on up there at the time of that incident, though, didn't you?
Well, yeah, I was trying to get around Wally, and I sort of looked like I was going to go in low. Wally committed to go in low, so I changed my line, and George must have been on the outside. And until I went and saw what happened, you know, like I said, I never knew he was there.
Stan Fox out for unrelated reasons here as we go back topside.
Well, there is a look once again at the black number 3, the Ben's Tire Clinic of Jimmy Kuecker as he goes by Hillenburg.
He's running a great race. Jack Steck's car has won the race here before a couple of years ago, so it's not due to victory lane. It wouldn't be due to victory lane, but Jack Steck is a veteran around here. He knows how to set the race car up. All he needs is somebody in there that knows how to drive it. And obviously, Kuechker can do that here at this racetrack.
Well, Kuechker has had a long way to go, but once again, we've talked about it before. The winner last year came from 16th starting position, one back from where Kuechker starts tonight. Let's take a look now at his lap. Now keep in mind what Parsons was very good about what Johnny Parsons was running, so he's been consistent with the leader's pace.
Right, he really needs a yellow. If he's running the same speed as Parsons, he needs a yellow to catch up. But we can see Parsons right here, and we can't quite see Eric Gordon in the frame, but he is reeling him in pretty quickly.
Gordon had moved in on Parsons, and I don't know if Parsons got a hand signal from the pit area, but he started to pull back out and open up that gap again. As he pulls up behind Dixon, he goes by 92. That's Fedorchek. He slugs by the inside of Larry Dixon.
Yes, he does. He's running that race car. You might be exactly right, Gary. They might have said that Eric Gordon was catching him and step on the gas, and he did move out. He's moved out of three or four car lengths more than he had lead a while ago, but still Eric Gordon's running a real smart race. I think Eric is running a lot smarter race this year than he did last year, even though he's in second place.
Let's check out his groove now as we take a look out the back of the car as he heads into turn three.
Watch him as he goes through. Watch that white line. He stays right straddle of the white line all the way around. A very good line. Uh-oh, Jeff Gordon is finally going to pull in. He's finally going to give up the ghost. That's too bad. He had a great run going, two in a row. That's tough to do in this division, but it just wasn't his night tonight.
Well, as you heard, he is in the points lead most of this race, and he wants to try to win the championship despite all of his commitments to the Busch Grand National cars.
Well, luckily for him, Jimmy Sills is the other one that's in the race, and he's already out. So there aren't a lot of guys that were right up front with him, had a lot of points that are still in this race. But Parsons is the man right now, it looks like, to beat. He's got that thing dialed in. Look at how quick, look at the line he runs. He runs those left front tire, left side tires, right on that line, all the way around number one and two. He'll go into this track corner a little lower, drift up just above the line, right in the middle, more of a diamond pattern, and then coming off, back down across that white line, and then back up to the fence. It's more of a diamond pattern down there in three and four, and it's more of a complete oval down here in one and two.
In recent weeks, we have seen JP lead the midgets and the sprint cars, only to have Lady Luck look the other direction. This is a big payday for him if he can win it, $7,000 to the winner.
Yes, he's done a great, great job. He really needs some luck. He's had a lot of problems, a lot of really terrible misfortunes that shouldn't happen to anybody, but all we can do is cross our fingers for him. I know that Glenn Nibel and the crew down there have their fingers crossed. It's kind of odd, too. This is a Nibel chassis. It's not a factory-made chassis. This is one that Glenn Nibel built himself, as is the one that Jim Kuechker is running, the Jack Steck car. A lot of beasts, a lot of challenges, a lot of things like that, a lot of Oz cars, but these two cars are one of a kind.
There are many disappointed fans because this young driver is a spectator now. He is standing by with Dave Despain.
Well, it would have been a great Cinderella story to finish sixth in the Busch Grand National race, then fly here and win this one. Jeff, when did you feel it start to go bad on you?
I don't know. The motor just started missing really bad. I think it was just loading up with fuel. Seemed like it was getting too much fuel, but I tell you what, that beast was running tonight. I tell you, that thing was on a rail. I was just taking it easy, and I could just pass anybody at will. And it's just too bad because we had a really good car today. Things are going good. Oh well.
This is a tough question to answer. Can you tell me how frustrating it is to have a winning car and then have it all go away like that?
It's real frustrating, because it's not every race that you get that, this thing has been running so good the last three races. I didn't think anything could go wrong. This thing was just really working good. And I tell you, the tires, the car, everything is just running really good. Just like to thank these guys for coming out here and not knowing if I was even going to make it, it's just, I really owe a lot to my pilot, Henry Newell. He wanted me to say something for him, but I tell you, he's done a hell of a job getting me to these races, and I couldn't thank him enough.
You out of hats?
Well, there's a lot of people who want me to wear these hats, so again, I just like to want, I want everybody to come out to the Coors Light AJ Foyt Hoosier Hunter, because, we're going to try to make it there, and we're going to try to win another one, and so there's a lot to win there. I think it's a $20,000 prize for winning both of them, so we're not shooting for that. We want to win. We want to win the points.
All right, that is Jeff Gordon. He's out for tonight. He'll lose his point lead very likely, and we'll be back with more from Indianapolis Raceway Park after this timeout.
When way I work, I sure appreciate my new Suzuki King Quad. It's great for fishing, too. Caught 9 bass last week. It hauled all the wood to build Martha's chicken coop. It took me hunting, spent all day shooting geese.
Check out the new King Quad ATV at your Suzuki dealer now.
You plowing tomorrow, Wayne?
Yep.
Don't forget your fishing gear.
Suzuki recommends all riders take a training course. In fact, it's on us. See your dealer for details.
Hey, everybody, let's go. We asked these experts on summer and dad to help introduce the new Master Values program. Now get 10 to 25% off only with MasterCard. From cool things to pack for vacation at Montgomery Ward, to house paint at Sherwin-Williams, to a Sony Walkman at Woolworth, and lots more. Then watch the savings pile up. Look for Master Values only from MasterCard at these and other fine stores. And master the moment.
Say, kids, what time is it?
It's Kids Day Free Time at Quality Comfort Clarion and Sleep Hotels.
Huh? Kids 18 and under stay free at Choice Hotels when you call 1-800-4-CHOICE and reserve a room.
All ready-to-serve orange juices start out equal. Most brands take out nature's water to form a concentrate, then put water back in. But here's one brand that doesn't. Tropicana Pure Premium. It's not made from concentrate. Nothing's ever added or taken away. In fact, no other major brand comes closer to this than this. Sooner or later, we think everyone will reach the same conclusion. You just can't pick a better juice.
What is a hit?
Trail of broken hearts.
How can we be lovers if we can't be
friends? If it's on VH1, it's a hit.
VH1.
The greatest hits of music video.
We are back live at Indianapolis Raceway Park. We have a yellow on lap 82 for some debris on the racetrack.
It was a radius rod, it looked like, that fell off of a car. There he has it in his hand. You can see him walking off with it. I don't know exactly which car it came off of, but I imagine whoever's driving the car will figure it out real quick and pull in, because it won't be very comfortable without the radius.
Jerry Niemeyer just pulled in, so it could be the red number 98 that lost that radius rod. As the yellow flies, that means the pace car is out. The field will bunch up, and this well could be to a youngster's advantage. Eric Gordon rides in second position in car number 81. That is the Epperson Lester car. He was second in the series a year ago. He was also second in the sprint cars a year ago. But right now, to the yellow, he bunches up behind Johnny Parsons.
It's going to be very, very interesting to see what happens here, because he does have an excellent chance right now.
Well, Johnny Parsons is out in front, and he's been cruising. But I tell you, he had to work a little bit to get that lead, because at the time, Jeff Gordon had built up a 4-second advantage, but in traffic, Gordon got tied up, and here comes Parsons in traffic in the yellow 20.
When you get this many cars, look at this. He goes down here, 4 abreast, clear to the inside, clear almost down to the grass, up, almost touches Jeff Gordon, but doesn't come up on the racetrack. Look, he's still in the bottom groove, going down the back straightaway. Here, Jeff bumps Trey House on the outside. Parsons again, clear down inside that last line, slides up.
Almost gets together with Gordon,
man.
Again.
Very, very close. He worked very hard. He wanted the lead at that point in time very, very badly. And Jeff Gordon was still running pretty doggone good.
Are you surprised he worked that hard this early to get the lead?
Well, I think he knew that was his best chance to get the lead. In traffic, when somebody else is running interference for you, it makes it a lot easier to pass, especially a guy like Jeff Gordon. You don't get very many opportunities to go around a man like that.
Well, although Stan Fox is out of the race, he has a big fan watching him, because it's his teammate from the Indianapolis 500, Gordon Johncock, a two-time winner, standing by with Dave Despain.
Hey, and Gordy dazzled him this year at the 500. Started 33rd. He was half sick and ended up sixth in the race. That wasn't a bad Memorial Day for you, was it?
Well, no, it wasn't bad, you know. I guess it was just a matter of survival, though. We outlasted him. Too bad it didn't go 600 miles. I think we could have won it. We had lots of fuel left.
You'd have stayed out there and run, too, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I sure would have.
You had a favorite here tonight, but it ended up being kind of a short night. What's the story?
Yeah, Stan Fox, he was running real good. Had some problems. I guess the car jumped out of gear. That put him a lap down. He wasn't able to get back up there. Then they had some more problems besides that.
You and his car owner interrupted a pretty good fishing trip to come down for this race. What do you do now? Head back for the woods?
Yeah, we're going back. We're up to Ron Hemmelgarn, the car owner that I drove for, and Gary Runyon, the sponsor of Jack's Tool Rental, on my car, and we're going to go back up there tonight. And just like to say hi to all the gals up there. My wife, Sue, you know, they didn't get to come down. We didn't have enough ride room in the airplane, so they had to stay up there, and I'm sure they're watching it on TV.
Good to see you, Gordy. We're going racing. Back to Gary and Larry.
We are indeed, as we take a look at Gene Lee Gibson. He is out of competition. The green flag flies, and Johnny Parsons once again picks up the pace, and look at that gap now. Not a real good start for Eric Gordon.
Now, Parsons got a big jump on him, really pulled away on that restart. I don't know whether Eric just couldn't pick up the throttle. He had a little stumble on the bottom end, but Parsons really, oh, but Parsons got a little sideways right there. He doesn't want to do that very often, or he'll be in big trouble. Jimmy Kinker, he's a pretty big benefactor there, too. He's only got two cars between him and Eric Gordon now. That'll help him a lot. But look there at Steve Butler. That's him down on the inside in that 10 car, just slid up in front of those guys. He is on the move also. He is really quick at this point.
Look at our buddy Steve Chassie there in the number 69 car. Takes a look to the inside and then tries to go by Andy Hillenburg.
Yeah, these guys are still racing pretty hard. They're down there. They're down a lap. I think these guys are down a lap, but they're still racing for position. All those guys are in right front of him are on the same lap, and he is, and he's going to go after him.
Well, there's a look at the black number three, but let's go back and take a look at Chuck Gurney is also riding with an in-car camera this evening. Chuck Gurney, a former Silver Crown champion. He has won 9 times in this type of competition. He's driving that black number 29 of Boston, Louis Seymour.
It's a very good race car. We know that Gurney can run a race car. Here we see it. We know Boston Louis puts a good car out. They missed the setup just a little bit. They're back in about fifth position right now. But Gurney's he's pretty smart cookie. If he gets that thing just dialed in a little bit better, if he can just do something to figure out the racetrack a little bit better, he could go forward real fast. He was worrying. I was talking to him in the pits earlier. He's worrying about his son, Charlie. He's out there running a quarter midget today, and he was on the phone telling his wife how to set that race car up. You can see right there, he has a pretty bad push. That car doesn't want to turn going around the corner. That could be slowing him down. As a matter of fact, it's got to be slowing him down a lot. That's the reason. See, way up to the fence, it won't turn. He's got a very, very bad front end push, and that's what's causing him to slow down.
Right now, for him to go forward, he needs a yellow to bunch that back up again.
Well, he certainly does, but I think when he slowed down, the tire's cooled off. Look at the front end. Look how far he's got that right front tire. It's really pushing bad. I think the yellow actually caused the race car to push worse than it was before. Look how far. Look at the right front. Look how far he's turning. He's keep turning just to get a turn. Yeah, he's got a real, real bad push. We can watch him down into this next corner. Watch him go in there. He goes in low. He drifts up. He keeps turning, but he keeps heading for the fence. Look at him. He's really got that right front crank around. He finally gets a load down towards the bottom, but it's pushing pretty bad right at this point in the race.
That means it's a real workout for the driver in the cockpit when that chassis not working.
As I said before, the guys up front are working easier than the guys in the back. Well, the guys in the back are always working the hardest. Although Gurney's in sixth position, he's not in the back.
We talked to drivers this point in the race. Right now, Johnny Parsons would appear to be the guy that's going to win this thing. He is hearing every noise that race car is making, probably right now talking to the race car.
Well, with his luck, he's got to be imagining all sorts of things. He knows that he's been close to the end before and had problems, and he thinks it might happen to him again. But he's going to run the race car as straight as he can. We see Eric Gordon. He's running that thing hard. He's got her sideways, and here comes Kinker. Everybody's going for the downs now. They can't afford to wait anymore. Only 6 laps to go.
5 laps, actually, to go right now as Parsons was given the 5-lap signal from our starter, Wally Shear. So Parsons now about a turn advantage as we take a look at the number three car, his number three in the lead serial. That is Jimmy Kinker. There's the gap from first back to second. About a half straightaway advantage now for Johnny Parsons. This is what he needs. He really needs this.
He certainly does. He's really wanting this race car just to last. He's got it pretty well handled if it'll finish the race. Eric Gordon, I know, has worked his heart out here tonight. He's run really quick. But again, I think he's going to come home the bridesmaid instead of the bride.
Well, the other car down the inside is Mike Podorcek as we go along for the ride. And you can see from the cockpit, he can look ahead and he can see Johnny Parsons. And he knows that Johnny is leading this race. But right now, it looks like he's going to have to settle for second. And we look back, and you really can't even see Jim Kinker back there riding in third position.
I think even a person like Gary Gordon at this point, he knows there's no chance that many laps to go. He's going to save the car, salvage second, hope that something goes wrong with John, because that's the only chance he has at this point.
And he's probably very aware of Johnny's luck.
Here we see Pankratz and Russ Gamster, 2 laps to go. Gamster's working on it pretty hard. Pankratz has been having a little trouble with that race car. Got loose early, but it looks like he speeded up. Here's the white flag.
There was the white flag for Parsons as we watch that battle for fifth position as they go by a slower car right now.
Yeah,
That looked like Mike Fedorchak, and here comes Parsons around. He's only got one more corner to go. He's got things. He's even smiling.
And look at the fans standing up down here. The fans are standing ovations as Johnny Parsons takes the victory. Dual checkered flags. He salutes the fans as Eric Gordon will take second position. And this is a very, very popular victory here at Indianapolis Raceway Park for Johnny Parsons.
You can't be much happier for a guy than we are for John Parsons. I got to tell you, this guy has led so many races, run so well, and had so many doggone things go wrong with race cars this year. Nobody deserves it. I got a lot of friends out there, but nobody deserves it more than that man right there.
Well, as many times as he has been out in front to have something mechanically go wrong to put him on the sideline, I'd tell you, a very popular victory, and they're still standing up applauding as he takes a victory lap. He may take two or three victory laps out there before he pulls that V6 in. He has plenty of fuel left as the victory lane is now forming down here on the front straightaway. All the other cars are going to be in there, and John's still out there circulating. So Johnny Parsons from nearby Brownsburg, Indiana, takes the victory here as we take a look from the in-car from second place, Eric Gordon. We're coming back to talk to Johnny Parsons.
Help celebrate the biggest Ford sales event of the year. It's Ford's Great American Parade of Values, going on now at your Ford dealer. Featuring America's best-built, best-selling cars and trucks, like America's number one selling small car, Ford Escort. And right now, you can buy an Escort starting at just $78.91. Or get this hot GT model and save almost $1,500 from the factory. And that's before you make your best deal, where quality is standard. Your participating Ford dealer.
Some things in life are predictable. Sure bets. You take one action, and you know what will happen. Like advertising on cable. You're bound to reach people you'd never hit with other advertising media. That means new customers. And new customers make more new customers. And more. And more. Call Telecable Targeting today.
Racing here on ESPN, but I don't think I've ever seen a more popular victory.
Well, like we said, Parsons certainly deserved it. He's a crowd favorite. He's always got time to stop and talk to the fans, to sign the autographs. He does all the right things with the people. He's a very, very popular guy, and everybody knows how unlucky he's been. Dave, have you got him down there now?
Yeah, we got him calmed down enough that I think he can talk to us. Can't help but remember, we did our Ventura Memories earlier tonight. The very first guy we talked to, the pole sitter, fast qualifier, the very first night was this guy. Been a struggle turning that into a victory circle visit, hasn't it?
It certainly has. It certainly has, Dave, and appreciate you and ESPN coming to the races. It does a lot for auto racing, particularly the type of vehicles that we're running here, and not to mention our sponsors and the individual drivers. Appreciate it.
Well, I tell you what, when you see the reaction of this crowd, we know who the hero of this show is. Man, they loved it here.
Well, you know, this is Hoosier Heartland, and they're always for the underdog here in Indiana, and I'm one of the favorite underdogs, I guess. It just turned out that way, but God bless the crowd here. They've been with us, and we had a safe evening, and I just praise the Lord all the way around.
I want to know, they speculated in the booth that the last four or five laps, you must have been listening to every noise. That's an old cliche. You hear that about every race car driver who's got a big lead. Right. But for you, as frustrated as you've been, I imagine those noises were pretty loud.
Not so much the noise of the car. You know, Glenn Nibel and Gene Nolan, the guys did a terrific job. They're great. You know, the best you could ask for as far as the crew goes. It's the sounds of Eric Gordon. You know, I saw, you know, at first, you know, Jeff took off to a heck of a pace, and I had a little bit of a push understeering the car, and I couldn't stay with him. I just didn't want to get too far left in the dust, and eventually that pace was a little bit hot for all of us, I think.
That traffic helped you a bunch, too. Looked like 4:65 at 5 o'clock when you and Gordon, Jeff Gordon, finally got together out there. Tell me about that little fandango through the traffic.
Well, it seemed like just as Jeff had been catching the lap traffic, his car slowed down, I think, a little bit. I don't know for what reason or not, but I just was able to be in the right place at the right time for a change, and we ended up finishing one. But he's a heck of a racer. And just to come in here with very little practice, we know he's a pro, you know, and he set a hot pace there.
Congratulations, man. You put the kids all behind you tonight. Good job.
It's great. Great to win. Thank you.
That's the winner, Johnny Parsons, 100-lap champion here tonight. We'll be right back with more from Indianapolis Raceway Park.
Kelly LeBrock reveals the essence of man.
Hard to define, easy to know. It's in the way he holds a drink, the way he wears his clothes, the way he talks, the way he walks, the way he smiles. looks and kisses. And when he holds you close, it's in the way he smells. Brute, the essence of man. Come on, put it on.
I scream, you scream. We all scream for ice cream. Ahem. We all scream for ice cream.
Yeah!
Thank you. Hershey's chocolate syrup.
With Matchlight, you get the best charcoal, Kingsford, with just the right amount of lighter fluid already added. That's why there's only one match for Matchlight from Kingsford.
If it happens in baseball, you'll see it on ESPN.
There he goes. He leaps. He makes the catch.
See Tuesday night doubleheaders, Wednesday night excitement, Friday night twin bills, and exclusive Sunday night action.
The Los Angeles Dodgers are leading the National League West. The bionic arm of Oral Hershiser is back to its old dominating self. The Dodgers face the Braves live at 8 Eastern on ESPN, Sunday night baseball.
About a year ago, Eric Gordon blistered this racetrack for 89 laps and ended up blistering the tire. You took a little more conservative approach tonight, and it got you second spot.
Yeah, JP was on a string, and there was, it was almost impossible to touch him. The only way I could do it, I could get him better in traffic because I was making more risky passes. That's the only way I could make a run at him. Goodyear tires, Epperson Lester champ car, wrenched by Phil Schuler, was running good all night, and it's just one of them deals. I was really, really hoping to win this deal tonight because we have a new sponsor on board, Waffle House Restaurants, 24-hour family restaurants here in Indiana, and we were hoping to give them their money's worth. Hopefully, we got them enough airtime showing them JP's tail there. got a little bit of airtime for both of us.
Last year, he led it most of the way and ended up third. Tonight, he settles for second spot, but he's got the new sponsor. Eric Gordon is our runner-up tonight. We'll be back to wrap it up right after this timeout.
You don't have to worry when rain keeps pouring down, because your home can take it, whatever comes around.
Olympic Oil Stain has pure linseed oil. Since oil and water don't mix, it helps stop water damage.
It's no wonder we'll stop the rain.
Olympic stops the rain. All Olympic products are on sale now for a limited time at Sears.
It's one of the most technologically advanced, most rigorously tested fluids on Earth. Relentlessly measured for maximum protection against the friction, the wear and tear, the heat and stress of today's engines. It is today's Quaker State. In Europe, in Japan, in America, Quaker State quality has passed the most demanding tests automakers can throw at it. At Quaker State, we don't just say we're tough, we're tested tough. The big Q is one tough motor oil.
Saturday Night Thunder has been brought to you by Quaker State. The big Q is one tough motor oil. By Bud Light, everything else is just a light. And by AutoZone, the right parts at the right price. In-car cameras provided by CarQuest. For your nearest CarQuest dealer, call 1-800-492-HART. You'll find it at CarQuest. 100 laps for the USAC Silver Crown Cars. Johnny Parsons Jr., the best of the bunch tonight. How about it, Gare and Lair? Pretty good show.
Well, I think that our victor said it all. It was a good, clean, safe, competitive race.
Very exciting race. I loved it. It's on to the Hoosier 100 now and possibly the richest purse in dirt car or silver car racing history. It's going to be great to go there and try to win it.
Well, we take a look at the top 15. Once again, Johnny Parsons, your victor over Eric Gordon, Jimmy Kuecker. A nice ride from starting 15th to 3rd. Steve Butler takes 4th, and 5th is Wally Pankratz. In the second five, we have Russ Gamester, Chuck Gurney, Steve Chassie, Larry Dixon, and Tony Elliott. And then 11th through 15th, Trey House, Gary Heber, Andy Hillenburg, Mike Fedorchek, and Greg Staub. Dave?
Well, that's going to wrap it up here tonight for the big cars, but the little cars are coming right back here to Indianapolis Raceway Park, and so too will Saturday Night Thunder be here to bring you every lap of the action. The USAC Midgets right back here at IRP next Saturday night. Coming up next, of course, got baseball tonight with a complete rundown on the stick and ball scene here for this afternoon and tonight, so stick around to get up to date on everything that's happening in that department. We wrap things up here with a big congratulations to Johnny Parsons Jr., winner in the USAC Silver Crown Cars tonight. For Gary and Larry, I'm Dave Despain. See you next week.